So the deal that OPEC and Russia came together to do back in November of 2016 that Steve referenced worked for a while, but they got help. They got help from Nigeria being offline a lot, Venezuela cratering, Libya as well. Well, they got sort of tricked here because the Russians and the Saudis in particular ramped up production, ramped up exports ahead of what was supposed to be severe sanctions on Iran. And when the administration gave the 8 waivers to Iran's largest buyers, it undercut that whole equation. So now they went from really undersupplying the market by a lot. The deal, there was 140% compliance with this deal, this cutback deal at one point. Now it's down to barely 100% and going south. So now we've tripped into an oversupply situation almost overnight because of the severe reaction by Russia and the Saudis to cover for the Iran losses, which never materialized.
All right, so we have an oversupply situation possibly, hypothetically, building right now, and that's the reason why we're seeing prices slide as far as they have. Meanwhile, we've got the International Energy Agency saying that we could have a lack thereof by the year 2020. That's maybe helping to put prices to a bid this morning. But what is the trend of oil given that supply-demand dynamic?
Well, first of all, I think if you're trying to trade this thing, the 1.4 million barrel cutback that's being talked about now, you have to be skeptical of it. You're going to have to see some concrete action at this point. They're late to the game as far as trying to talk this thing up. I wouldn't necessarily trust it. To be only up 40 cents now in WTI this morning after that kind of announcement. At first, they were at a million over the weekend. Now it's 1.4. This is classic stuff out of the OPEC members and Saudi Arabia where you just can't trust it. I will tell you, but Dom, there's probably some blood in the street out there, too. This has the look of some kind of forced liquidation, the way this thing has sold off. But if you're trading it, now you want to be a little late to the rebound. Wait till you see the whites of the price recovery's eyes before you touch this thing, because for now, the downward pressure is remaining intense.
All right, so speaking of classic OPEC, one of the things that Mohamed Barkindo, the OPEC Secretary General, told Squawk Box Europe, he said that this is, in their opinion, the normal volatility that comes ahead of their conferences. We know that they got a meeting coming up early December, the 6th and 7th of next month. What do we expect out of that meeting, and is it largely priced in the market?
He's right to a degree in that the way I reference it is that the market forces OPEC's hand either to the downside or to the upside. Right now, they've already gone from 1 million to 1.4. The market is going to try to see what else it can get out of them. So prices may, in fact, be pushed even lower still for a while to generate maybe a 1.5 to 2 million barrel type of cutback when the meeting rolls around. That's what they're facing. The other problem they have, though, that's not of their making, is the recent strength of the U.S. dollar, which has just been incredible. Incredible. So crude oil prices trade in direct opposite to that because it's dollar denominated. But also, too, the normal sort of demand response you should get from a price fall like this is being obviated by that dollar fall because emerging markets, the key growth markets, they're still paying up. They're still paying triple digit type of oil prices when you do the currency translation for countries like Turkey, India, Indonesia, and the like.